to our show that is called Real Shame. It's a show where we watch movies from our movie list of shame or movie blind spots, basically movies that we haven't seen, and we're fixing that for you. This week, we have some movies that I haven't seen, and to introduce the first movie, in case you can't... we didn't introduce ourselves. Before we introduce the movie, I'm Adam.
I'm Mad Max.
He's Mad Max.
No, I'm Mad Andy. I'm just Andy.
All right, well... That's who we are now to get into the introductions of the actual movie we're going to talk about this week. Let me toss it over to Mad Andy. Good day.
What are we watching? Good night, mate. A few years from now, Max Rockatansky and the last of a dwindling police force try and maintain law and order in Australia in Mad Max.
Hey, Max.
Hey, Max.
Go ahead.
We are 100% snafu.
You okay?
Nothing the air in the tropics wouldn't fix.
Much damage?
You should see the damage, Bronze, huh? Metal damage.
Brain damage, huh?
Are you listening, Bronze?
I am the Night Rider. I'm a fuel-injected suicide machine.
So Mad Max was directed by George Miller. George Miller has directed all of the Mad Max films. There's four of them. He co-directed Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome, but he still was in the director's chair. But outside of the Mad Max films, he has done some rather eclectic films. Yeah. He's directed some rather eclectic films, like The Witches of Eastwick, Babe, Pig in the City, the sequel to Babe, and Happy Feet 1 and 2, which... I've not seen the Happy Feet movies, and when I was looking through his filmography, I was like, really? George Miller did Happy Feet 1 and 2?
Yeah.
So, very very interesting, and again, eclectic kind of mix of films, outside of the four Mad Max films that he's done. And I think he's done one or two others. Lorenzo's Oil, I know he directed that, I didn't put that on there. But anyway, Mad Max was written by George Miller and James McCausland, and the score is by Brian May. And it's not the Queen Brian May, not the guitarist from Brian May. He shares the name with the guitarist of Queen, but this guy was an Australian composer, did a lot of Australian films. So the score is by him.
And he passed away a couple years ago.
Yeah, he's gone. He's gone from this mortal coil. It stars Mel Gibson as Max Rockatansky. This was an early role for Mel Gibson. Mel Gibson, American-born Mel Gibson, by the way, born in New York and then moved to Australia as a child, much like Nicole Kidman, born in Hawaii, moved to Australia as a child. So neither one of them were born in Australia.
That's
fun fact.
New to me.
Yeah, Mel Gibson, born in New York State. Not New York City, but New York State. I forget the city. Anyway, Steve Bisley plays Goose. Roger Ward plays Fifi. Joanne Samuel plays Max's wife, Jesse Rockatansky. And the final person that I'll call out is Hugh Keysburn. He plays the villainous Toe Cutter. So Mad Max is a movie that you have not ever seen before. You've seen Mad Max Fury Road.
Yes.
Have you seen any of the other Mad Max films?
I've seen...
Road Warrior or Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome?
I saw Fury Road in theaters.
Yeah.
I think I've seen clips of Thunderdome.
Okay.
And I've seen, like, maybe screenshots or whatever of the Road Warrior. Like, because some of the characters looked familiar, so I must have seen them, like, somewhere before, but...
Right.
I've not seen Mad Max, not seen The Road Warrior, and I've not seen all of Thunderdome. So, you know, I jumped right in on the fourth one. I was like, let's go.
Yeah.
What is it about?
Just out of curiosity, did you feel like when you went and saw the fourth one, were you like, man, I'm not going to know what's happening or anything like that? Or were you just like, I don't care?
Honestly, I don't remember if I had that thought, but I will say watching it, I think the connective tissue is, well, without seeing the third one now, I don't think they're really that interconnected. They kind of,
the fourth one, it's almost like a reboot.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah. And also,
I guess maybe it is a reboot.
What's his name? Venom in it. I can't think of his name right now.
Tom
Hardy.
Yeah, Tom Hardy.
I mean, is I guess he plays Max, but they really rarely ever say Max, but that, I think that's also a theme of the movies or something that happens a lot in these movies where... So, I mean, I it could be any character. It could be slotted into almost any of these movies and stuff like that. So, I don't know if I knew that going into it because, you know, I listen to stuff like this. People talk about it. So, I didn't know if going into it if I would have known that hey, I don't really need to be that caught up on the Mad Maxes to be able to watch it and all that kind of stuff. Because I don't remember like seeking it out to watch them or anything beforehand. I just went to the theater to watch it because I heard it was the visual feast, and that it was.
Yeah, for sure. All right, so diving into the original Mad Max from 1979, I guess, obviously, we've already established you've seen Fury Road, so you know the Mad Max kind of mythology, or at least a little bit of it.
Yeah.
What else did you know about it, and what did you think?
I didn't know much about it. I knew, you know, I didn't know, like, I think the Road Warrior was the first one to come to the States, and it was called Mad Max here in the States, and then Mad Max came out. I don't know. Maybe that's wrong, but that's kind of the history I remember of it.
Yeah, Mad Max technically did have a release over here, but like nobody really went and saw it. So when they put out the Road Warrior, when they put out Mad Max 2, they retitled it Road Warrior because they were like, American audiences don't know what Mad Max is.
Yep.
So, yeah.
So I didn't know much going into this. Knew Mel Gibson was in it, and that's about it. So in watching this movie, the thing that struck me was, this really didn't feel like what I would think is a Mad Max movie, right?
Yeah.
Because it has that opening title card where it talks about it kind of taking place in the near future, the not-so-distant future, or a few years from now.
A few years from now.
Yeah, that you cleverly added to your intro. So it takes place a few years from now. But honestly, when you look at it, it really doesn't look like dystopian or run down or anything like that. Like, it looks almost like, like it's, you know, filmed of its day and stuff like that. So for me, watching this movie, it really didn't feel like what I think of a Mad Max movie, with like, you know, desert and them hunting for gas and all that kind of stuff. And even in this movie, it seemed like the needing of gas wasn't a huge driver. Like, it wasn't like as hard to find as it would be in later films.
Yeah.
So it was really interesting because it plays to me really different than the other two of the four movies that I've seen, right? And just like and you can see kind of like the beginnings of different things, the different themes you take, but it really feels really different. Honestly, I was thinking between like Mad Max and the Road Warrior, for me it was drawing a lot of El Mariachi and Desperado kind of vibes.
Yeah.
Like, it's like the differences and the change and how we're kind of carrying themes through, we're carrying a character through and all that kind of stuff, but, you know, using a bigger budget to kind of fill it out and stuff like that. So for me, that's kind of the parallel I was drawing
That's a very good comparison, very good parallel. I like that.
So with Mad Max, overall, I liked it. I would say probably about 40 to 70% of the movie, I thought I was not going to like it.
Yeah.
Because it starts off like crazy, right? It starts off with a bang. Like, you have that car chase.
The Knight Rider.
They're running through everything. You have the Knight Rider, and it's awesome. And then the movie like drops into this lull where you kind of figure out like what the day in the life is, and, you know, figure out the world and stuff like that. And it gets really like monotonous, and there's really not a whole lot to it, I feel like. And then, you know, some violence here and there, you know, his partner gets messed up. Max decides to quit and all that kind of stuff. But when we get to, and we're going to spoil the movie, obviously, because it's our title of the show. When his wife and dog get killed, or his dog gets killed, and then his wife and son get killed in the movie, and then when it turns into like what I would call like a revenge flick, that's when the movie really picks up a lot of steam and gets interesting for me.
And there's only like 15 minutes the movie left. Yeah. It's very, very rushed there at the end.
And it saves it for me, right? A little bit. And I wish, you know, like, you know, in hindsight and all this kind of stuff, I wish her death came sooner and the movie was a revenge flick for more of it, of him hunting it down and stuff like that. Because I like the overall story, and I think in this one he has the biggest arc than he has in any of the other movies. I think he kind of changes the most from, any of the ones I've seen.
No, I agree.
So I think he changes the most. So I like that arc. I just wish, like, they would compress the monotonous stuff and then would have expanded the, you know, the revenge, like him hunting down each one of them maybe and all that kind of stuff. And I understand, like, this movie was made for a shoestring budget, and the things they did on the budget is insane. So, you know, so obviously I know there was a lot of constraints they were working with, and that probably wasn't feasible. But for me, watching it, you know, overall, I liked it. I did feel a little bit of the constraints of the budget around the way the story was paced and, you know, how the mayhem happened. But overall, I kind of liked it. And it, like I said, it wasn't really what I was expecting, but I ended up enjoying it. So that's kind of my take on Mad Max. Have you, you've seen it before, obviously. Have you seen it? Yeah. How many times have you seen it? What was the last time you saw it? And what did you think about it this time around?
I've seen it a handful of times. So weirdly enough, out of all the Mad Max movies, the one that I've seen the most is Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome. The third one.
That was
that's probably why. Yeah. I'll get to that, I guess, at the end of the show when we talk about what we've been watching, because I did watch that one as well. But yeah, I've seen this one, maybe six times, something like that. I don't know. And bits and pieces of here and there, you know, throughout the years or whatever. And I feel like I watched it within the last 5 or 6 years. I feel like this is something that I've watched more recently. But you took the words right out of my mouth with a lot of what you said, because I completely agree with you. I wish that his wife and his kid would get killed much earlier in the film. Because to me, I don't think I'm very high on the film anymore. I think initially when I saw it, because I'm pretty sure I saw this after Road Warrior, know, like most American audiences did. I think I was let down by it after seeing Road Warrior, because Road Warrior has a lot more action and, you know, whatnot. And so I don't think that I was as keen on this movie when I initially saw it. I feel like I've warmed up to it a little more over the years, but watching it this time, I was like, not that big of a fan. Yeah. And it mainly has to do with what you said. I feel like, yes, you start off bang with this car chase, and car chases are what Mad Max movies are all about, right? Fury Road is essentially just one long, or, you know, a couple of different, you know, car chases back and forth, right? And Road Warrior has a lot of, you know, car chase. Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome has a car chase. You know, that's what these movies are known for. So you start off with that in this film. And then, yes, I feel like not a whole lot happens after that. It's very much meandering. And You want this to be a revenge flick. You want him to, as you said, go hunt down these guys one by one by one. He needs some kind of impetus to do that. Well, his partner, like, gets, not technically killed. He gets burned. Yeah, he gets burned horribly.
Fingers get bit off.
I mean, that would be enough. You know, I feel like for him to go off and be like, I'm going to get these guys. But then on top of that, then they kill his dog. And then they kill his wife and his kid and everything. And it's like, how many people do they have to kill before he finally sets off on this revenge trek? And yeah, I feel like that part of the movie is just kind of really rushed there at the end. And I like that part of the movie, but I wish that it came way sooner. Wish that the individual people that he hunts down took longer. Because some of those guys, it's just like, bam, bam. He, like, kills them fast. Yeah. It's, like, super quick. And then he kills, in fact, he kills Toe Cutter, who's, like, the main villain with the bulging eyes there when he runs into the truck.
Love it.
Yeah. He kills Toe Cutter before he even kills Johnny the Boy. Well, technically, he doesn't kill Johnny the Boy. He gives him a hacksaw and says, you know, you can hack through your ankle or whatever or whatnot. But that part of the movie is so it almost feels tacked on there at the end, and it's so rushed. I can appreciate this movie for beginning the Mad Max mythology and for being, as you said, you know, very good for the budget that they had, and they do some cool things with it. But I more than anything, I respect this movie for the blueprint of what would be the Mad Max mythology. I don't think when they made this, they were thinking about making a sequel.
No,
you know, I think that they just made this. Yeah. They're like, we want to make essentially a biker film. You know, in biker films, there's plenty of biker films that precede Mad Max. And it's always kind of a similar thing. The bikers come to town.
Yeah.
They're harassing people. They're terrorizing people. And, you know, some citizen has to stand up and take control. You know, and in this case, he happens to be a police officer. But it's essentially that same kind of thing. Or I guess technically, because it's Australia, they call them bikey, not biker. They're like, it's a bikey film.
Well, no, so like,
yeah, it's a bikey film.
They call them hoonigans too, right?
I have no idea.
They use the term hoon.
Hoon, okay.
Yeah.
So it's a bikey film or a hoon film or whatever. So it's essentially that. It's a play on that. It just happens to take place a few years from now.
Yeah.
But yeah, they hadn't quite gone full on dystopia, people wearing, you know, football pads and having mohawks and painted faces
we'll
and all this kind of stuff. Although Toe Cutter does look, I mean, I will say some of the bikey gang you know, they do look a little bit, you know, like they would in later movies, especially Toe Cutter with his crazy hair and everything. Yeah. But this movie, again, people may kill me in the comments or whatever for this video. I'm not saying I dislike this movie. I'm just not really as warm on it as I used to be. I'm much more warm on, you know, the sequels to it.
Yeah.
But this film, I respect it for the, the kind of what it started. But I'm not a huge fan. And I have a lot of notes here, but really the main thing I want to say is I feel like Brian May's score is way over the top. It's very bombastic, and I feel like it gets in the way. Kind of like Ennio Morricone's score in Casualties of War.
I'm not sure if that registered with me when I was watching it, but I can definitely see that. Yeah, I'm with you. I think I'm giving it a little bit more credit because A, it's the first time I've seen it, and B, because it's the impetus of so much more that kind of takes place afterwards and stuff like that. But it's one of those, like, I mean, I will say for me, I much prefer Desperado over El Mariachi.
Oh, I do not.
For me, it's kind of like in the same kind of thing. Like, there's things about El Mariachi that I like, and I like that it's the beginning of it, but I like, you know, the bigger budget version of it, you know, a little bit more, but I like kind of where things come. So for me, I think that carries the movie a lot more for me than it is for you.
Right.
But I agree. There's it's just one of those things that's like, it's not, it's good to have seen and know where it comes from, but it's not, I don't feel like it's one of those movies that I'm going to watch over and over again or revisit over and over again. It's like it might be like you haven't seen this, it's worth checking out kind of thing, rather than like, oh, it's Friday night, what am I going to watch? Let's put on the first Mad Max.
I will say one other thing about the movie is I love the intro of Max in the movie because you don't see his face for the first little part of the movie. The chase is going on with the Knight Rider. The other cops are trying to get him. You see Max kind of lying in wait in his police car, and you see like the side of his head, or you see like his shades or something like that. You don't ever fully see his face until he kind of walks up on the road and the camera kind of zooms in on it. I think that's a great like intro to the character.
Yeah.
That's very, very cool. It's almost like comic bookish to me. And the fact that they're, police station is like the halls of justice or was kind of cool or whatever. So there's some neat, interesting things that the names of the characters like Knight Rider, Johnny the Boy, Bubba Zanetti, Toe Cutter, that stuff is fun. And there's plenty of fun things I think in the movie. I just think overall, and part of it probably has to do with just, I'm almost like, harder on it because of the sequels, because I feel like the sequels are superior. So and maybe that's unfair, but you know, criticism is like that, right? It's subjective, not objective.
That's right.
So,
right. Well, so we talked about where we land on it.
Yeah.
You have anything else to add? Where are the critics on this?
We touched on this earlier. So the movie was released in 1980. So it was released in 1979 in Australia. Released in 1980 by American International Pictures. But they didn't, I think they were in a transition state. Like I forget what it was. They were being bought by another film company or production company or something like that. But they just didn't give it much of a release. And they were afraid of the Australian dialogue. They were afraid that audiences, American audiences, would not understand what they were saying. So they dubbed the dialogue. Oh, wow. So if you saw this movie back in theaters back in 1980, you did not hear Mel Gibson's voice. You heard some other American guy's voice. And I think they dubbed over just about everybody. They left a few little bits of Australian accent in there, but they dubbed over it with American actors. Thankfully now, you know, obviously you can watch the versions, that are not dubbed or whatnot.
And you can put on subtitles. You have a hard time hearing them.
Yeah. But again, when they released the second film over here, you know, they were like, well, we should retitle it something because nobody's going to know what the hell Mad Max is. Hugh Keysburn, that plays Toe Cutter in this movie, would go on to play Immortan Joe, who's the villain, the big bad, in Mad Max Fury Road. And that was actually his final film role. He died about 5 years later. He didn't make another film in that time. But this movie is 90% fresh on Rotten Tomatoes, 70% audience score, and Leonard Maltin gives it 3.5 stars.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
That's because you said Leonard goes up to 4 or 5?
4.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, that's crazy.
Yeah, 3.5 stars. I did not find a Siskel and Ebert review of this. They do have a review of Road Warrior.
All right.
But not this movie. Or at least
I didn't find one. Hint for later in the week.
All right.
All right. Well, that was our thoughts on Mad Max. Maybe you can let us know if it holds up for you or if it doesn't. On these Monday episodes, we always like to talk about what we've been watching. So I'm going to pass that over to Andy. Andy, what have you been watching?
Well, as you just mentioned, we'll go ahead and spoil it now. For Wednesday's movie, we did pick The Road Warrior to this with. But I went ahead and watched the third and the fourth film, Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome and Mad Max Fury Road. Again, I've seen Thunderdome more than any other Mad Max film because it's playing on TV all the time when I was a kid. And I've seen Fury Road. I think this is my third viewing of Fury Road.
Did you watch the black and white edition?
No, I have still not seen the black and white edition. Okay. I've not, and I didn't see it in theaters. Every time I've seen it at home, but I have a nice pumping sound system, so it sounds, man, friggin' great. It sounds so cool, like just coming all the speakers and everything. Sounds, the sound design is top notch, and I really like the music score as well by Junkie XL. Like that music score. But so I just want to touch on Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome. It's not my favorite Mad Max film. But, and honestly, I don't, it's probably the weakest out of the first three. I think most people think out of the original kind of trilogy, Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome is the weakest one. But I have a lot of nostalgia for it because I saw it as a kid. So I would put it behind The Road Warrior. And that's a spoiler for how I feel about The Road Warrior, which we're going to talk about next time. But I would put it after Road Warrior. And then I would put, now this is not the original trilogy. I'm kind of doing Fury Road separate. But I would put Mad Max third. But Thunderdome, I really like a lot of it. I think it falls apart later in the film, and you haven't seen it all the way through right?
I've just seen clips, yeah. So,
I'm not going to spoil it. Plus, we're not reviewing it, so I'm not going to say any major spoilers or anything like that. But I do wish the basically second half of the movie was as good as the first. I will say, I think Tina Turner is actually really good in it. So she's it's one of those times where you're like, oh, it's a singer, a musician who's trying to act, but I think she fits the role that she's in pretty well. And
I think she's like, isn't she supposed to be like the person that's running Thunderdome or like the announcer?
Yeah, she runs. Well, it's kind of a power struggle between her and somebody else about who runs Bartertown.
Gotcha.
But I think she's good. I mean, I don't know that I've seen her in any other movies. I know there's a biopic about her starring Angela Bassett, but she's obviously not in that. Or yeah, if she is, she's in a cameo or something like that. But I think it would be cool if they could bring back Tina Turner for like a future movie, because I know they've got Mad Max movies in the pipe, like the Furiosa movie.
Forever to make.
Yeah, apparently. But I think that would be cool. But I like Thunderdome overall, although I will admit it has a lot of faults, but and a lot of it has to do with nostalgia. Now Fury Road is one that I think when I saw it the first time, it was super, super hyped up. Yeah, so when I watched it, I was like, yeah, it was okay, but like, what's the big deal?
That's how I felt.
But
how I feel about Fury Road.
I have come around on it. I mean, I the second time I watched it, it was a couple of years later, because it came out in 2015, so it's been, 7 years now. The second time that I watched it, I liked it a lot more, and now watching it this third time, I'm a fan. I think it's really cool, and it's super exciting. Like, it's... There is a few kind of spots where they're not driving, but they're few and far between. I mean, it's mostly just a long, extended chase scene.
They're driving to the water, then they're driving from the water.
Yeah, I mean, but there's just a lot. I mean, there's some silly stuff in there, too. But I think overall, it's really fun. I think, again, the music score and all of the kind of the effects and the stunt work is just incredible. So I'm a big fan of that film. I wish they would make another film, another Mad Max film, with Mel Gibson back in the role. I think that would be cool. I don't know how that would work now, since they kind of technically rebooted it with Fury Road. And the next film that's coming out is supposed to be Furiosa. It's supposed to be a prequel to Fury Road. And Furiosa is not even played by Charlize Theron. Anya Taylor-Joy is who's at least supposed to play it right now. I don't know if that will continue, because I think the release date is not till like 2024, so it's still very much kind of up in the air. But I wish Mel Gibson could come back, and I wish Tina Turner could come back. Bruce Spence, who's in Road Warrior and Thunderdome, I wish he could come back. I mean, I think it would be cool. Nowadays, we've got Top Gun Maverick and Bad Boys for Life and all these legacy sequels. I wish that they would do another one with Mel Gibson and everybody back.
Forever.
Yeah, I think it'd be awesome. Just to have Legacy. everybody come back. I would be there opening day. I think it would be really neat. So the final film, and I'll shut up and kick it over to you. The final film that I wanted to watch, or that I did watch, is kind of a precursor actually to the Mad Max films. It's called Stone. It's another Australian bikey film, and it was a very low budget. I mean, I think the budget was a little over $100,000, which doesn't sound low to me, but by a lot of standards, it's fairly low. But it was kind of a lower budget bikey film that they made in 1974 with, honestly, a bunch of no-names. The one person, I mean, no-names to me, maybe they were very well-known to the Australian audiences at the time. I did recognize a couple of bit players in the movie. One of the ladies was in Picnic at Hanging Rock, which we did. But other than that, the main cast of characters was a bunch of people that I'd never heard of. But I actually really liked Stone. I thought it was a cool... It's, again, you know, we have a sliding scale when it comes to film criticism half the time, right? It's like a movie gets put out in Hollywood that's big budget and it's not very good. You really, really lambast it. But yeah. If a lower budget movie gets put out, it usually doesn't get the same level of criticism kind of thrown at it because you give them credit for trying.
Yep.
And I think this movie, objectively, it's not the greatest, but I actually had a lot of fun with it. And it's one of those movies, because I had the Blu-ray of it, and I watched a lot of the special features, and they had, like, behind the scenes, they had, like, a retrospective with the interviews with the people now, and it was really, really fascinating, just kind of the stuff they were talking about and how they made it, and it made me like the movie even more. And I mentioned it because not only is it, like, a biker film, again, it's not post-apocalyptic or anything like that, but it has Hugh Keyes-Byrne as one of the guy that plays Toe Cutter in Mad Max, and Immortan Joe in Fury Road. He's one of the stars of Stone.
Gotcha. So
Stone is the name of a biker guy who's basically like an undercover cop, and he rides along with the biker gang because there's a guy that's trying to kill this biker gang. There's like a professional hitman that's trying to kill him, so he's trying to figure out who it is. But again, low budget, you know, kind of almost like Mad Max, kind of meanders a little bit, but I had a lot of fun with it, and I thought they did a really good job with what they had. So I enjoyed it. What about you? What have you been watching?
Well, I've been watching, you talked about Hollywood and big budget movies, and yeah. I've watched two of those.
Okay.
I watched the latest entry in the Fantastic Beasts series. I think it's called The Secrets of Dumbledore. That's what I have in my notes. I don't remember, I wrote that from memory. That
sounds right.
Sounds about right. I keep on wanting to call it The Crimes of Dumbledore, but it was The Crimes of Grindelwald.
Grindelwald, yeah.
So this just appeared on HBO Max. I don't know if it hit theaters at all in the States or not. I don't remember hearing much about it or anything, but it was on HBO Max, so I watched it there. Man, it's so tough because David Yates, the director, he directed the last few of the Harry Potter movies. He's directed all three of these. He's really good at visual storytelling and stuff like that, and it's really pretty to look at, but they're just not giving a whole lot to work with. J.K. Rowling wrote the first two, and I believe on this one she had help writing it. And she just, I don't know if she needs more time to let her ideas bake. I mean, apparently, if you look at her Twitter account, she's kind of off her rocker a little bit and little out of touch, I would say, is maybe a nice way of putting it. So I don't know if she needs more time to bake her ideas down or if she needs a longer format, which is a novel, to tell these ideas, but these movies are just terrible when compared to any of the Harry Potter movies before. Like, they just don't even hold a candle to them, and it just feels like, it feels like a cash grab, and it is a cash grab, but it has, like, some of this, it has the writer of the novels, and it has, you know, director of the last movie, so it is a cash grab, but it feels like it should have enough stuff there to build something out of, and it really doesn't. I think the biggest crime of this movie is it's kind of boring, and it's minor spoiler for the movie, but Dumbledore says that Grindelwald can basically see the future through some mechanism. I'm not going to tell you what it is. And so the only way to bring him down is not to have a plan. And so we're watching a movie where it's like, well, there's really no plot, right? Because having a plan, having an idea, having a direction, a path, is akin to having a plot. So basically the movie is just kind of like randomness, like different random scenes, and they kind of tie together, but they really don't. And for me, I just feel like I don't even think it's a novel idea. It's an interesting idea, but it's one that's so execution dependent that I would say only the best writers can get away with having something where it's like, we have to make it seem like we don't have a plan so the bad guy doesn't catch on. Because when you're watching, you're just like, they don't know what they're doing, and I'm just watching one scene from another and they're not really connecting together. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, and it's just boring. Like, parts of it are just, like, beautiful, but it's really boring. And it's just, I don't know. It's disappointing. And I really was down on the first two movies, but I rewatched them last Christmas, around last Christmas, and I warmed up to them. So maybe I'll warm up to this one, but liking those movies a little bit more, I kind of had a little bit higher expectation for this one. And this one is, I think, the worst of all of them. So just kind of disappointing. I do think Mads Mikkelsen is amazing. Like, I mean, Johnny Depp was terrible casting, in my opinion, for Grindelwald. He just didn't bring anything to the role. I thought both, spoiler for the first movie, Colin Farrell and was great as him, and I wish he stuck around. And I think Mads Mikkelsen brings a lot to the table, too. It's disappointing is the hardest part, right? It's so disappointing, and of this kind of stuff. So I don't know. That's kind of where I fall on it. The other movie I watched also on streaming, this one came out only to streaming, is Chip and Dale Rescue Rangers. So this is directed by the same guy from Lonely Islands, who directed Popstar Never Stop Stopping, Jacome, I think his last name is. Or something along those lines. I don't have a rundown, so forgive me if I'm wrong. When I first saw the trailer for this, I thought this movie was going to be a stinker. And then I heard, like, through the grapevine that it's actually pretty good. I was hoping for, like, a Barb and Star kind of thing where, like, I was going to be surprised how good it is. And when I watched it, it was just okay. Yeah. It's not as great or as funny as the reviewers were saying. And I don't think it, like, made me have high expectations or anything. I just think I had average expectations. You know, I know I like the cartoon, the Rescue Rangers, and all that kind of stuff. So I was kind of looking forward to it. And it's just okay. It's just not funny that much to me. I don't know. It just didn't really hit well with me. I mean, it's one of those, maybe your mileage may vary, I guess. If you like more of the Lonely Island stuff and, like, you know, the other movies he did, maybe the humor would work better for you and stuff like that. So for me, it was kind of disappointing, I guess, really. Because it just was okay. You know. So those are two things I watched. I watched the, you know, new Fantastic Beasts movie and then the new Rescue Rangers movie. So not a great week for those kind of movies, but whatever. It happens. So we've already talked about it, but this is the part of the segment where we do it.
Yeah.
What'd you pair with Mad Max and why did you do that?
I paired Mad Max with Mad Max 2 because I did not think you had ever seen Mad Max 2, and I knew you hadn't seen Mad Max. So I thought, you know what? Let's just do them both together.
I think it was a good idea.
And so we did. So on Wednesday, we'll be talking about Mad Max 2 or The Road Warrior or Mad Max 2 The Road Warrior, whatever you want to call it. Doesn't matter. You know what I'm talking about.
That's right. All right. All right. Stay tuned for that. Well, that was our thoughts on Mad Max and everything like that. Let us know what you think about Mad Max, the first one, down in the comments below. Let us know if you still think it holds up, you like it, all that stuff, that kind of stuff, blah, blah, blah. Let us know. Please like, subscribe, share, do all that social media stuff. It really does help spread the word of the show, and we really do appreciate that. And stay tuned on Wednesday when we find out what it takes to become the Road Warrior. And we'll see you soon, guys.